A lot of things I want to talk about and let you know why I'm coming here. We're going to start a podcast show, and me and some other people, we're going to get together and we're going to bring you good information. You know, we're going to talk about things that are going on in the world today. We're going to talk about things that are going on in the past, that went on in the past. You understand? We're gonna some of the fairy tales that you've heard. We're gonna get rid of that bullshit. Like the fairy tale they told you that Clive Davis, you know, saved Puff after he was thrown out of Uptown Records by Andre Harrell. You know, that was a bunch of bullshit, man. You understand? Puff got fired from them from that City College bullshit. Andre Harrell got tired of his shit doing this little bullshit. You know, some shit happened out in D.C. when people got trampled. You understand? People don't talk about that. I think a couple people probably died out there in that little concert he had put together because he was using, you know, the people that he knew from Uptown and his connections to give parties. That's what he used to call Daddy House and everything like that. So when he got fired from them, you know, it was people like D. Ferg, Eddie Uff from Heavy D and the Boys, Tim Dawg, people who was paying his card note, giving him a place to stay. You understand? People who was taking care of him, making sure he had money in his pocket. You understand? You know, that was saving because the nigga was on suicide watch. D. Ferg said, yo, this nigga about to commit suicide the way he talking. So we had like a suicide watch out on this nigga. You understand? And then he got hooked up with Wolf and them, Buck Naked. That was Buck and L. I think Buck probably went to school with him. Corey, he probably went to school with Puff. And he started this thing called Buck Naked. A booty ain't a booty unless it's Buck Naked. That was their code. And they used to give a lot of parties. And I was the guy at the front door of their parties. Because Tim Dawg used to hire me, you understand, to make sure the outside was good. Because I had a crew like that. You understand? So the crew with the 12th Street Posse, Slick and the Family, we used to run all the outsides of all those heavy hitter parties. You understand? So it wouldn't be no situations. You understand? So Tim used to hire me to do the party. So Buck Naked, this is the same guys who was like, I heard before, you know, like, and I could tell you, they was the real bad boys behind the situation. You know, they was so much of bad boys that them niggas got 9-16 to life sentences. And they just was pardoned by Obama. You understand? So to know the truth of the matter, they was the one putting the money behind the engine a bad boy until Puff could get up there to Clive Davis. You know what I'm saying? What Andre Harrell didn't do was do the same shit that Puff used to do to motherfuckers and like have him blackballed. You know, he could thank Andre Harrell for that because Andre Harrell didn't have him blackballed. See, Puff is the type of motherfucker, he'll go and tell motherfuckers, don't fuck with that guy no more. Don't do that with no guy. Don't do business with him no more. You understand? That's why you get the great artists like Craig Mack, Black Rob, you know what I'm saying? Them niggas who, you know, got crazy jewels in the game that could spit they motherfucking ass off, they can't get work or jobs no more because Puff tell motherfuckers not to do business with them. You understand? And people who do business with them, he shade they motherfucking ass. I seen it done too many times. That's the reason why I put in my documentary that Wendy Williams wasn't there no more. You understand?
And on Everything I Love, that came out of his mouth. That's the same time he got Wendy Williams fired, because we were out there that whole weekend and Wendy Williams had released some pictures of Puff, and it appeared that a man was pulling down his pants. What actually happened was, is that Puff, we were all in Cancun and we were going to the Island of Women, the Island of Women that they have in Cancun for them to do a show and a party and everything like that. And the kid, Chris Lattimore, was playing with Puff and pulled down his pants in front of the girls. And I guess somebody snapped a picture of it or whatever like that and sent it to Wendy Williams. She put it on her website, I guess, emailed her website and everything like that. And it appeared like that. So Puff was on the phone with the people from, I think she was at WBLS at the time. And she said, he said to her, "Yo, if I get back in New York City and that BITCH is on the radio, y'all won't get nothing from no one who deals with Bad Boy, none of my friends." You know, he just started naming people that he had connects with and told them that your shit will be boycotted. I'm looking back like this and I'm saying to myself, this nigga ain't gonna get Wendy Williams off the radio. She too hot for that. You know, motherfuckers love her. And when we got back in town, Wendy was in Pennsylvania. I was like, yo, wow. This nigga got power.
So, you know, Buck and L, they was the real engine and the money that got Puff to Clyde Davis. You understand? Because Big still had to do shows. He still needed money for his pocket. He still needed, you know what I'm saying, to get in the studios and everything like that, to do the tapers, to do the records and everything like that. I even got a tape that I got them on stage with them niggas. You understand? You know, I got a VH1 tape that I think, you know, he left with me by mistake. They got all that shit in there. So, you know, he can say, and y'all can hear that fairy tale shit about Clyde Davis. You understand? He might took him to the black back of the boardroom or something like that and blessed him. You understand? But all that bullshit about, you know, that he was the money and he was the engine behind Bad Boy getting started. Nah. You understand? Because Kirk Burrows was the brains behind the shit. You understand? Knowing how to get the money, knowing, you know, how to write the shit up. You understand? For the artists, for the people, and taking care of that bullshit. You understand? Because when we was doing the parties and Puff had the red zone, the building and everything like that, we would always take the money over to Fifth Avenue to Kirk Burrows' house. He stayed over there on 111th and Fifth Avenue, across the street from the Schomburg. So all that shit, they get on television and you see in the Bad Boy story that they was going to Scarsdale with that shit. That's bullshit. They try to X Kirk Burrows out of his legacy of starting and doing everything for Bad Boy. You understand? You know, the shit is crazy the way they get out here and they want to fool you. And then when a motherfucker like me get on here and start, you know, talking and telling and saying what really happened, motherfuckers say, yo, I'm a snitch. Get the fuck out of here. Nigga, I ain't snitching on no motherfucker about it, because ain't nobody, I ain't got no criminal record where nobody could go to jail for whatever I tell. Now, I could tell some shit for a motherfucker to go to jail with, all right? You know what I'm saying? Don't get it fucked up. You understand? Because he knows that. He knows that. So, back at this bullshit that we talking about, you know, this fairy tale shit with Clyde Davis, scratch that out your fucking thought process. Yeah, Clyde Davis ended up bringing him to Arista because Arista was looking for a rap a situation and everything like that. But it wasn't because of, you know, he Puff didn't have the avenue, and he had an artist, and he had that. He got that because he kept the engine going with the Bad Boy money from Buck and L from Buck Naked. And you know why they got fucking 9-16 to like sentences, because they was out there doing their motherfucking thing as entrepreneurs, street entrepreneurs. It ain't no, it's public record, so it ain't no motherfucking, it is what it is. You understand? You know, these cats get out here, you know, and they don't have no honor no more. You understand? You know, they want you to think it's all right, you understand? And they hard body because they sitting around here kissing other men in the mouth and, you know, dressing like they feminine and everything like that, and want you and the masses to think, yo, it's all right, that's the new millennium and shit. If it was the new millennium, I don't want no motherfucking part of it, bruh. You understand? I'm good. I'm not going to be the old nigga in the chain in the motherfucking club with a chain tight around my neck and everything like that. I'm not going to be the old nigga that you going to see with no motherfucking tight jeans on. You understand? You understand? I'm not going to be the big old nigga with none of that shit on. That's what it is. Nigga, I'm good.
How you doing, Chili? My name is Frank. I just had a brief question for you. I watched a couple of your interviews, and you talked about taking Clive Davis hostage. And I just wanted to, because we've seen the movie, so
that happened.
Yeah, I wanted to just touch on that and just get, you know, get the outcome of that,
like what the real deal.
Yeah, what happened? What transpired after that?
Okay, well, at that time, well, we had already left Pebbles, and so we had a lot of questions. We weren't making any money, and you know, we were selling albums and all that, and so LaFace Records was, you know, they point to Arista, and Arista would point back to them, and so we're like, well, shoot, let's just go to the head, and that is Clive Davis.
Right.
So Lisa met a few friends when she was, you know, after the burning of the house and everything, she was in a little trouble. You know, she was at this little center.
Oh, Lisa.
She met some tough girls. They were big. No, I'm serious, like way bigger than you, like huge. Like you would almost think they were like dudes, but they were girls, like look like this, but like, hey, you know, like that. You remember them, I know you do. So she gathered her crew, and she and, she and those girls, Antion drove.
And Tay-Tay.
Yeah, and Tay-Tay, which is Tion's cousin. Tay-Tay don't play. And they drove to New York. I got on a plane, met them there, and we had a plan. So, you know, we didn't have any plaques. We didn't have nothing. So we instructed the girls. We said, all right, we're going to go up to Arista. And I said, we're going to call. And I said, I'm going to do the talking. And because, you know, Chili's the sweet one. Okay. I am sweet. If you cross me, I'm not.
I was about to say, she's sweet, but rah.
Don't mess with me. But anyway, so we told the girls, you know, when we go there, go on every floor. I can't remember how many floors there were at Arista at the time. And we said, anything that says TLC, from the plaque to a regular poster, we don't care what it is, get it. And go and put it in the limo. We had already talked to the limo driver, he was ready. He was like, okay, cool, I'll park right here and I won't leave until y'all say so. So we call up, ring, 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 you know, hey, it's TLC for Clive. He's like, hi, girls, how are you doing? I was like, hey, Clive, you know, we're in town, we miss you, we haven't seen you in a while, we wanna come up and say hi. Yeah, girls, come on, yeah. So we get there, and we got the girls going, and then we go in the room, and then, Lisa's cousin. I don't remember. What? No. Tay-Tay is Tion's cousin. Lisa's cousin was there, too.
I know
You know who I'm talking about. And we walked into Clive's office. Puffy was in there playing his, that's when he was Puffy, playing his music and stuff. And so, you know, we walk in, and of course everybody's like friendly and ready to say hello. And Tion's cousin walks over, at the time it was a tape, stops the tape, gives it to Puffy and says, TLC's got a meeting with Clive and you got to go. Your meeting's over. And Tough Puffy is like, he didn't put up a fuss or nothing, but he was confused, of course, and so.
And what's funny is he told me the exact same story from him. His perspective is the funniest.
So he goes out, and we have one of the girls acting as security outside of that door, and we said, don't let anybody in or out unless we say so. Okay, so Clive is like, girls, girls, what's going on? And so we're like, we need to talk to you. Because we're broke, we don't have no money, and L.A. is talking about you, and like, we're just going on and on and on. And there was another person that needed to be in that meeting who handled finances and stuff there. So he called him on, you know, on the intercom or whatever and said, come to the office. Then the guy calls back, he's like, those ladies or bodyguards won't let me in. So, and mind you, somebody's already called the NYPD because the other girls are like going all around taking plaques down and everything. And so of course, you know, can you imagine like working? You're like, wait a minute, what's happening right now? Are we getting robbed? Like, you know, and so, after that, you know, the other gentleman comes in and I start talking and then I get all emotional because I'm mad, I'm crying. And so this is like for real. And we said, you know, it's not fair. We're selling all these records and we don't have anything to show for it. Like, this is not right. Because we thought, we were like, we got rid of Pebble, so we straight. No. And so he actually saw how serious that was. Now, at this time, the police is there. Hold on, y'all. This is my son.
So hey, the police was there. I wasn't there. I was in Atlanta. I ain't had nothing to do with it. I just heard all the stories.
I love you.
Pat, he's calling you right now.
I know, right?
There go Pat right there.
That's my mini-me. So anyway, long story short, the police comes in the office, like two of them, and I'm not lying. It was like a serious movie at that moment. The three of us just looked at Clive like, if you have us arrested, we are gonna F you up for real. Like, don't get us arrested. So he was like, cause the officer was like, you know, is everything okay? Everything okay? And he was like, he looked at us and that's when we gave him that look. And he was like, girls, girls, why do we need all the security? And come on, girls. And we're like, okay. You know, then we turned into some sweet little things in front of the cops. And that was pretty much it, you know, like L.A. was called, Puffy called L.A., like, yo, man, you don't, but like the girls are going crazy and all this kind of stuff. But because we didn't have anything to lose, you know what I mean? We didn't care. We wanted to go straight to the source and say, hey, what is the problem? Like, can we be in something? Give us something fair, you know? And then after that, that's when we started to renegotiate our contracts, the whole filing of the bankruptcy happened and all that kind of stuff. And in the end, we won, but we stuck it out because the lawyers that we had in Georgia was looking at the money that we were making and was like, what's wrong with y'all? And we're like, no, you can't look at what we're making. Look at the albums that we've sold and what we should be making. You know, and so we had to, you know, drill him and thinking that we got to fire this guy and start all over. I'm telling you, it was like really crazy. But doing that, it helped us, you know, as far as the deal and them giving us something fair. I wouldn't suggest that you guys go that far.
I was going to say moral of the story.
Yeah,
don't
please
do that.
Don't do that. You know, there's another way. But, you know, that's.
Something to say, no. You gon' listen today, no. Can we talk about the guns going off and the false accusations? I'm afraid of my own generation. Can we talk about it? No. Can we talk about the blood on the pavement? I bet they gon' be afraid to play this song on rotation. But I'ma talk about it. Well, I'ma talk about it. Baby, can we talk about it?
Yeah. Most certainly can.
We talk about it?
And I ain't gonna take too much of your time.
No.
Yeah. First thing they say is stop killing. But can we talk about the cop killings? Before we talk about the crack dealing, they acting like blacks ain't got feelings. Knowledge of self is through wisdom.